I talk a bit about, if I look back over the past, say, 5 years in the financial crisis, we have seen bank failures. We have seen companies that came into trouble. Whilst other companies, they survived. They seem to be more sustainable. But I think if I'm a bit critical, probably the whole way that we led the companies or that we were supervising the companies, we didn't do such a good job. You may always say the circumstances were tough, but probably more failures happened than we thought that would be possible in the year 2008. And then I think it always goes the same. The company comes into trouble, so on the first day in the newspaper, it is all about a director or a division of the management. On day two, it is about what did the CEO do. On day three, and how about the supervisory board. On the fourth day, what did the accountant, the external accountant, what did he do? And on the fifth day, they have usually found a regulator or somebody else. And before the week is over, you start already to get claims from shareholders or other people. That is the pattern. Now, I highlight my speech especially on how I see the role of the CEO and the chairman of the supervisory board. I think they are the two key persons who have to act. My last remark about sustainability, it was in fact an ex-Shell person. He wrote a book, Why Certain Companies Existed for 400 Years. What were the common characteristics, features of those companies? And I only mentioned three here. All those companies who lasted very long, they are very conservative in finance. So they work with a lot of own capital and low debt. The second one is that they allow experiments for new products and services. So they are not very rigid, but the top persons of the company take ownership of that. So they don't push that away into the divisions. And the third one is companies have a strong sense, what I just called company culture or own identity, which is relatively constant over the time. Ladies and gentlemen, I come now to the end. But the organizers, they asked me, can you give a specific answer what did not work in your experiences? And I could easily write down immediately four of them. And I will be brief. I think if your supervisory board is too big, more than 10 persons, then is probably your board less good. I think a smaller board in numbers, people take more ownership. And it is quite amazing to see that banks in general have very large boards compared to industrial companies. So I think this is a coincidence, but I'm not so sure. Yeah. The second point is a chairman of the supervisory board who is only a facilitator. So he conducts the meetings in a very nice way, but basically he doesn't do anything. I think that's not good enough. You must have the capability at a certain moment to say, no, the buck stops here, you can jump up and down. So you must have the guts to do that. But the second thing is quite dangerous as well, if a chairman is too executive. Yeah, I think then you don't give enough space to the CEO. I'm not going to mention names, but if you follow the British press, you can see some examples there in the past. And the last one, I think, is my most important remark. A CEO is there to serve the company. It should be company first. So it is not the CEO first, or the Americans call it I first, or it is me first in the UK. No, it is company first. And not all CEOs, they get a bit too happy with themselves.
Still, you said that today CEO is king, but there's no I and there's no me, and it's company first. But still, how do you avoid that power struggle? How do you make sure that it's a corporation and it doesn't become a power struggle?
Yeah, I think the way I always start, if I read certain papers or quarterly reports, whatever, I prefer always first to listen. And not just You don't say to the CEO, I'm here to listen. No, no. You say, I read those reports and I wonder, and then I come with my non-leading questions. And usually then people will open up. Or another way is, if you see the CEO, if to give a very simple example, many chairmen will ask, what is going on? Very safe question for a CEO, starts to tell something he likes to tell. Then you, but you can ask as well, what is not going on? I repeat that, what is not going on? The CEO thinks, what a strange question, because what's going on? So there should have been something going on. But if I tell that, probably he will ask, and that's correct, why didn't you do anything about it? Yeah? So you see there again an example that you have to be very careful how you ask your questions. And I think that is the right way for governance.
Let's just end where we began in the boardroom. A lot of these CEOs here, some are already serving in boards, others has ambition to serve on a board. What would be your best advice how to make yourself, let's say, interesting for a board that's looking for new expertise? How do you do that?
You know, I think my best advice is that you can combine. So if you think on a board, the art of asking those questions, non-leading questions, that needs a bit of practice. And so you first listen before you give an opinion. But if you first listen and if you have asked first the right questions, you can be quite directive. But it is very dangerous if you immediately start what the Americans call as advocacy. Don't do that. So first, I say always, I got my flappy ears not for nothing. Yeah? So I first to listen, and I do that on the basis of questions. But after that, I can be quite, no, we go there, yeah? And not there.